Aloha and mahalo and hello, and I have something very important to share here, the deepest insight ever today, and I'm still functioning somehow. I found out that what the ego is trying to do is not only get us angry at God and the Holy Spirit so that we don't want to return home, that's actually secondary. The primary objective is to get God angry at us so God doesn't want us to return to reality. And that's solving the continuity problem, saying, well, we can't go home because God doesn't want us to come home. So really, the primary objective of the ego is to somehow get God really, really, really mad at us. For instance, Jesus, the whole story of Jesus, God sending his only begotten son, so to speak, into the world, and then we savagely butchered him. Why? To get God angry at us. Super mad. So the ego wants to get God to say, you know what? You behave in such an atrocious manner. I never want you to come back to reality. You're banned forever from reality. And then we all say, oh, isn't that wonderful? Wow, finally, we've solved the continuity problem because we can't go back home. This is what's underlying the whole thing. Amazing insight. It turned everything topsy-turvy today. I was going about the day, just reeling a little bit, just saying, wow, it's a completely different landscape. We are trying to enrage God. The thing is, though, we cannot get God angry, but that's our purpose. No wonder why this mistreatment, so to speak, of Jesus. Anyone who comes to speak the truth in this world, like a speaker that God sends into the world, the ego wants to mistreat them severely to anger God. So God says, look what you've done to someone I sent in to help you. I'm never going to try to help you again. And the ego says, that's what we wanted. That's what we wanted. Amazing stuff. So I'm just soaking this in because it's such a revelation, and I've been just absorbing it today. It's such a game changer. I just like am stunned by it. So of course those who are trying to help us get from yes to no, in terms of lies, saying no to lies instead of yes. Of course, the ego sees that as, let's make life as miserable as possible for them. Let's just torture them. Let's make things just so terrible that God says, you know what, I'm never going to send anyone else here ever again. That's it. No more. And then the ego say, fantastic. Mission accomplished. Unfortunately, this is a fact. This is a fact, and so I have to adjust to this fact. Whew. And we'll see how that adjustment goes. So, stay tuned for that. Stay tuned for that. This is such a game changer. It's just like, wow, I need to take a step back just to gain a perspective and gain a sense of humor. The fact is, you cannot help people get from yes to no without a great sense of humor. Without great tact and a great sense of humor, otherwise it's going to be too much for you. And right now the world is so much focused on yes to the exclusion of no, and has no sense of humor about it. It's such a bad situation that, again, you have to be a perfect teacher to help even a little bit get to no in a direct manner. So it's necessary for me to take a step back and cool down. I mean, just the sheer viciousness of the ego's approach is something you need to cool down from, get a sense of humor about, regain the sense of humor after what I've seen. Everything I've seen is just like, wow. At first, you're just horrified by it. First, you're stunned. Well, let's say, at first you say, wow, I made a breakthrough. Second, you're stunned. Third, you're horrified. And fourth, you don't know what to make of it. And then fifth, you finally start gaining a sense of humor about it in some way. So it is necessary to have this complete, smooth, broad, wide sense of humor that sees everything, sees the madness of the ego. And so that's what I have to get to. And hopefully there's a situation brewing that'll bring that into focus. Because most certainly now I see, wow, everything is upside down and backwards here in the world. And people think that you help God to help. Well, basically the story of Jesus was the ego story of how God helped the world by giving us the opportunity to kill, you know, to kill the spirit, so that he would be so enraged that he would never have any, God would never have anything to do with us ever again, and we were completely unwelcome in reality forevermore. And that's for ego, that's salvation. The ego claimed victory, salvation, it's all over. We never have to go home. If you just believe in the crucifixion, if you just have this cross or image of Jesus, you know, tortured, bloody, crucified, that reassures you, saying, oh, God must be so angry at us that we'll never be able to go home. He's banned us permanently from going back to reality. And so we're relieved. We think, ah, the continuity problem, I don't have to deal with it. I don't have to go home. And that gives a certain superficial relief, absolutely, temporarily. But that's as far as it goes, because it's completely bogus, of course. But you know, that's what people have been using, the ego's been using that like a drug to give us a bit of relief. Now when you find out that God is a God of love and cannot get angry and can never banish us from reality, in fact we've never left reality, then that whole crucifixion thing doesn't work anymore. And you say, oh, you know, wow, what now? What now? And then you start struggling. So it's been a long haul to see this, and it's obvious, it's so clear and so simple and so basic and so obvious, and yet, you know, there's nobody seems to be able to see it. It because it's just like, holy smokes. I mean, yeah, I can see that now. One sec. You know, it's like you don't want to see it, but it's true. It is that when you come into this world and you say, I'm, you know, God sent me into this world to help out, and people say, great, okay, here's how you help. We're going to torture you, and we're going to make you so miserable, and you're going to mistreat you that God will be furious with us, and will never send another one into the world, and that's how you can help us. That's literally the attitude of the world, literally. Exactly what it is. And then they say, if you agree with that, then we'll make you, you know, the greatest saint in history. If we can crucify you, we'll make you the greatest figurehead of all religion forever, because you solved our problem for us. God now hates us forever, and we'll never have to go back to reality. Therefore, no continuity problem. That just shows you the depth of the continuity problem, what a severe fear it is, and how you really need to spend your life on this issue, looking at how the Holy Spirit can solve this problem and accepting that it has solved this problem. It's a absolute necessity. Otherwise, you're going to go along with the ego's program of persecuting those who come to try and help, try to go from yes, we can, accomplish the impossible, die to what we are, to no, we can't, we cannot die to what we are. So this is just, I'm still just in a wow, kind of wow phase. Not bad though. I'm used to breakthroughs. I'm having breakthroughs every single day now. Several big breakthroughs every day. But this one, I didn't see it coming. Well, I did, because I've been working in certain that direction, loosening up the fabric of that narrative. But then when it came into focus, I said, wow. What do I do with that one? My gosh, that's just such a mind blower. All egoic. And how the ego's idea of what salvation is so utterly crazy and insane. And how we follow it so slavishly because we're terrified of the continuity problem. Again, the more you lessen the fear of the continuity issue, the more you get free of the ego's madness, for sure. It is guaranteed. Just look at what I've been able to do. I've finally been able to penetrate the ego's, you know, core defenses. Get past them and see them, you know. But it requires a bit of reflection, and you know, I really love to go to some place where I can cool down and relax. Actually, that's what I need at this point. These are reverberating type of realizations for sure. So we'll see what happens with that. Meanwhile, you know, continue to go forward. There's no time, no, can't stop now. The basic issue is going from yes to no, all right? And one, well, if one has the right humor, perfect sense of humor intact, that just is able to absorb the complaints, etc., then one can teach anywhere, any place, anytime. It's all the same. Doesn't matter what's going on in the culture, because it's all the same. It's getting from yes to no. Same curriculum always, from yes to no. From yes we can to no we can't. Never. No we can't. Never. Can we ever succeed in killing ourselves and spirit dying? We can never succeed to making spirit flesh. It's impossible. And of course, the narrative of the ego goes even further. Says that God made himself or itself flesh. So then we killed God, and so God is no more. And the fact that we killed God here on this earth means this earth is the center of the new creation. There's that egoic narrative as well. Yeah, it's just very brutal stuff. And but again, a sense of humor is necessary. And how do you get that? Well, it's certainly possible, because I've done it many times, of bouncing back from these realizations to be able to laugh and smile and joke about it. Absolutely, it's very possible. It's essential, and I will get there for sure. Retreat from the world. Of course, the world insists that it's making all this progress, and you're missing out on the progress, and you won't be able to really connect and help out. Not true. Not true. It's not really getting anywhere. And the teaching is the same. No matter what so-called progress is made or changes are made, all that stuff's completely superficial. So you may, by stepping back, I may not participate, you know, and be at the hub of civilization like the Silicon Valley. But the humor and the tact and the calm that I gain is more than enough to offset whatever, you know, changes the ego has done, or the reconfigurations the ego has done about its defenses. Because basically, you have to absorb the, you know, resistance to whatever you say. And that's done with this enormous perspective and humor and compassion and kindness and clarity, etc. No matter who you're talking to, because it's all the same. You know, what you're talking to is people who have been following the ego's plan, trying to now, you know, get free of its plan. And of course, they're going to be kicking and screaming, and, you know, no matter what. Doesn't matter how much they've overlearned it, you know, you can only make the defenses so strong. And it's mostly a bluff. And so you have to be able to absorb the bluff with this great, great spiritual humor, so to speak, without getting rattled. And then once that is absorbed, then, you know, progress can be made. But right now, it's a time for a retreat, no question about it. But this is just a stunning recognition today. The ego thinks that salvation means getting God so angry that we get banned from reality. So therefore, the ego tries to attack whatever the ego thinks God holds precious. The ego will try to attack that, to infuriate the prime creator. So of course it's a dangerous thing in this world, trying to speak the truth. I've already experienced that for sure. And but on the other hand too, that the trap is that it's easy to think that you by suffering, you're becoming a great saint and you're helping the world. It's not true at all. That's what the ego wants. And if you're happy and blissful, the ego's furious about that. Because it says, wow, look at this one that God sent, so happy and blissful. He's not, really haven't been able to cause God any anger at all about this one. It's terrible. Then the ego will say, you're not helping us at all. So it's easy to get caught up in trying to help people and sucked into the ego's plan and then cause yourself misery and decide, you know what, the more miserable I am, the more happy people are, the more happy the ego is, and saying, wow, you're really helping us. Thank you so much. You're helping save us. Wonderful, wonderful. And certainly I've got caught up in that. No question. So many have. And just seeing this, it's such a groundbreaking insight. Just like, wow, yeah. Amazing. The implications of this insight are just off the charts. All the misery, all the martyrdom, all the suffering, everything has been to please the ego. Thinking that it's saving everyone. Because the ego says, hey, this is salvation. This is what works. And people saying, yeah, thank you so much. Thank you so much. Nobody even saying what's really going on. That the ego thinks that this is infuriating the prime creator. And therefore banning us from heaven forever. Never have to go back. So no continuity problem. The ego can say, what continuity problem? There's no continuity problem. We all kind of breathe this great sigh of relief. And yet the Holy Spirit tells us, not so fast, not so fast. Not so fast. God isn't angry at you. And the ego says, oh you really? Okay. We'll get God's favorite, and then we'll really sock it to God's favorite. Just get a hold of God's favorite. Crucify God's favorite and just terrible. Treat him just so terrible. Treat him or her so terrible, you know. And then we'll be saved. Just, you know, we got to get God. So the ego always believes that God can be infuriated. Absolutely. And this idea of God of love, the ego say, well, yeah, but God loves his son, you know, loves spirit so much that when we killed the spirit, that just, you know, caused God to go completely crazy with anger, you know, so we can't go back. It's too dangerous. We're banned. That's the ultimate objective of the ego, is to say, not that we can't go back because we're afraid of God, but that God banned us. In other words, so the authority of God is behind the whole situation, say, you can't come back. You can never come back. That is the ultimate objective, the end game of the ego. And so this just overturns the apple cart. You know, utterly overturns the apple cart on so many levels. So I'm just I don't know how it's going to shake out, actually. Really don't. I was driving today and just saying, wow, what's going to happen? I don't know. This is just an enormous shakeout from this. Changes the landscape just entirely. I can feel it. That this just upends so many belief systems, so much belief, just upends it so much. Yeah, it's bordering on being too profound, you know. it's right on the border there. Because the implications are off the charts. I cannot really, I can look at some of them, but I'm not sure what, you know, the totality of the implications. But now it should be fine. It should be fine. But certainly it sets the bar very high where it has to be. And that's important, to set the bar very high. But again, people don't like that. So you need very good humor to handle their disgruntlement. You know, they want the bar set low. They don't want this insight. They don't want to know this insight. It's a secret. It's their ace up the sleeve. Get God angry. You know? So that's why people don't tackle the continuity problem. They say, we got an ace up the sleeve. Once we play that, we don't even have to worry about the continuity problem because it's going to be solved. We have a solution for it. And And of course, the Christians say, we already solved it. It's been solved. We solved the continuity problem. God now has decided we cannot come back. So, but you know, others are saying, well, I'm not so sure. I'm not sure yet. Maybe we need to keep infuriating God on a continual basis. Maybe God might change his mind, you know. But the Christians say, no, it's been finished. It's been finished. No change in mind. God has now decided that we are unfit for reality because of the savagery we showed to Jesus. So we cannot go back home. We absolutely cannot. And we're just in this amazing seeing the extent of the delusion we have. That is what's shocking. It requires very unnerving and shocking. And the sense of humor is when you finally realize, I can handle this. It's no problem. Then it's all smiles and laughs. Absolutely. And that's needed. It's absolutely needed for a teacher to be all smiles and laughs, to reassure people that, hey, it's very, you can get past it, no problem. If you're all intense, you're serious, and you're still struggling, then people say, maybe we can't get past it. So most definitely, what I would like to see in the world is that the teachers who have truly gotten past it and are in bliss and joy and the laughter is there, these, and just, you know, and that's very reassuring that, yeah, you can have even these core insights and you can get past it and it all shakes out and everything is fine. And then you say, okay, no problem. So this is just another in a series of breakthroughs, but it's certainly, when you start talking at this level, people are going to, they may not, that's a whole different ballgame, really. Wow. It's not something that people have really considered. We're trying to find a way to get banned. So we can't go back. So that's why we're behave so, you know, so viciously. That's a whole new way of looking at things. My gosh, you can even extend it to the inhumanity we show to one another, to the viciousness, just the whole thing, why we're not in bliss, why we attack one another. You could extend it that far if you wanted to. And we want God to look at humanity and say, oh my gosh, how terrible. I can never have you in reality. You're just unworthy. So we're trying to make ourselves unworthy. Imagine the motivation we have underlying because of the fear of the continuity issue. The continuity issue is so fearful, it most definitely gives rise to this. And having experienced this, I know that is a fact. We will engage in any type of subterfuge to avoid this continuity issue where we feel a sense of eternal disorientation and chaos. It's the worst. So we easily would try to get God infuriated with us and or just to look at us and say, you're useless, you're futile, you'll never get it, you're a reject, throw him on the ash heap. We don't want, you can't be here in reality, no way. You know, we crave that, we crave condemnation from God, actually. We pretend like we're worshiping God, but really inside, we're craving the condemnation more than anything. So most of us are seeking that relief, just a sense of condemnation. And when you look at the crucified Christ, people say, I know God must condemn me over this, so how wonderful. You know, what a relief. I never have to worry about the continuity problem. Uh-oh, yeah, but not true. And maybe some people think, well, God has just condemned some of us, and the rest of us have not been condemned. So they hold up, they say, the hope. You know what? You can be condemned too. If you just accept the crucifix here, you can be condemned too. God can condemn you too, and then you don't have to worry about the continuity problem too. So you're saved also. This is really the salvation that I see the world, people having this relief that they think, I never have to deal with the continuity problem. That's wonderful. Because I've been banned. I've been condemned. And of course, myself, I know I have not been condemned and can never be condemned. So that gives me a whole different problem. You know, I can't get this easy relief. I have to get the relief of the Holy Spirit, who solves the continuity problem. The Holy Spirit solves the continuity problem by giving us a new perception. So that's what I have to do, knowing that I cannot be condemned. God cannot condemn anyone. It's impossible. So the easy solace of this, you know, the condemnation of, from God belief doesn't work for me. So that's why I've had such a struggle. And other people seem to be breezing through life saying, I don't have to worry, I've been condemned. And they call that being saved, you know, that they've been condemned, so they're saved from what? From the continuity problem. And saved from the continuity problem, they think. They believe it. Of course, eventually they find out otherwise. And then that's when they start having problems. When self-condemnation doesn't work, when the belief that God has condemned them doesn't work, then they have to rethink the whole thing. And then that's when a sense of humor helps out a lot. Just a laugh sometimes helps out so much, because they're really hurting inside when they find out. When it starts to dawn on them, they say, "Oh my gosh, I'm done for. I mean, this continuity issue is going to get me, you know." And then that's when the joyous ones just laugh and say, "No. It's already solved. The Holy Spirit has already solved it. No worries. You just have to accept the new perception. And you know, you can." Then spend your time clarifying it, because inside you're terrified, saying, "Oh my gosh, what do I do now that I realize that I cannot be banned from reality? It's impossible. I am reality. Reality cannot ban itself. Reality is all one. It's indivisible. We've never left. We've never done anything to anger God. This is just all a fantasy." So when you realize that, then you say, "Uh-oh, I can't do anything to anger God. Uh-oh, continuity problem is still there." So you see, there's two different pathways in the world, really. The ones who are desperately seeking condemnation from God, and the ones who have realized you cannot get any condemnation out of God. You cannot anger God at all. It's impossible. Then the two very different paths. Entirely divergent paths, you know. And again, yes we can, meaning yes we can get God, condemnation from God. And the no we can is saying no we cannot, never. Two very different paths, and so getting from yes to no is a spiritual path. That's the effort that one has to make. But it is unnerving. My nerves are just, you know, wow. I did get some sleep last night. And so I'm battling through day by day, you know, hour by hour. But obviously, there's a lot going on right now. The yes we can folks are trying to get ultimate condemnation from God by destroying the planet, you know, doing whatever they can do to try to get that condemnation they're seeking. And I tell you, the continuity fear of the continuity issue is so strong, it can lead to entire worlds being destroyed. Spirit is willing to destroy worlds, destroy everything, whatever it takes, destroy anything and everything, whatever it takes, just to avoid this sense of eternal disorientation as the worst. It's worse than destruction. Because Spirit knows whatever it destroys, it can always imagine something else, but this sense of eternal disorientation is the worst. Spirit, again, will do anything. So destroy a world, sure. It's trying to find a way to infuriate God. Of course, it says, first it says, well, God created this world. And then ending up destroying it, say, well, God must be really mad. And the way to make it even seem worse is to say, this is the only planet there is. This is where only life is here on this planet. And this is the center of the universe. This is God created planet. There's only life here, nowhere else. And then destroy the world and say, you see, God must now be completely, eternally furious at us for doing this. So we're safe from the continuity problem. But now when you start to open things up and say, no, wait a minute, there's lots of uninhabitable planets. Then this whole plan starts to fall apart. And when you have people escaping this planet, going to other planets, again it starts to fall apart because they say, hey, if someone escapes, God won't be quite as mad. Maybe we won't get condemned. But if we just kill everything here, then God will forget that condemnation we're seeking. So you see how this whole thing, this whole psychology of condemnation is at work right now, where the ego doesn't want anyone to escape. He wants to infuriate God entirely, but of course God cannot be infuriated at all. So this is a new way of looking at the situation now, a new dynamic, a new motivation for what's happening here on the planet. And it fits superbly. That's why the ego again is so much against anybody escaping what's coming. Doesn't want God to find any silver lining or solace. So doesn't want God to say, you know what, I was going to, you know, destroy, ban them for forever, but you know what, somebody escaped, a few escaped, and they're okay, and they're in bliss. So you know what, I don't think I will. That's, you know, the ego's afraid of that. Doesn't want any escape. And this underlying dynamic of condemnation, people are, for the most part, unaware of it and going along with it. So, it's like lemmings off a cliff. So, all right, this is such a game changer. We'll have to see how things unfold in the near term. Who knows? Maybe even another video tonight, we could connect it to this one. This is just like an extraordinary pivot. In the month of September, I said the month of September is a pivotal month. This is just the most enormous pivot. And I think I'll just go eat dinner and see how I feel later on. Beautiful evening here. All right. Let's find out what happens next. That's it.